Hello, everybody, and welcome to another Lion's Table. Let's take a moment to enter into the presence of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. Let God's word, which is truth, fill us and give us strength. Let us contemplate his great love for us, his sacrifice on the cross, his mercy and grace and promise of eternal life through Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the Word, who was at the beginning, was with God, and is God.
Indeed, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made, and without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. John 1, verses 1 through 5.
Who is it that overcomes the world, and who can win this battle against the world? Only those that believe that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by water alone, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies to this, because the Spirit is the truth. 1 John 5, verses 5 and 6.
So, dear brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, we are very happy for you to join us in this ark of God's Word. For faith comes by hearing God's Word. If anyone keeps his word, the love of God has been truly perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. 1 John 2, verse 5. And by this we know, again, by this we know that we are in him, and there is power in his name.
Amen. You know, last we were talking about working out salvation with fear and trembling. Well, how does one do that? Being mindful of our need of Christ Jesus, needing his mercy and his compassion. And so we are in need of discipleship. And that means we need each other. Love your neighbor as yourself means having mercy and compassion for your neighbor as you need the same.
Amen. And you know, last time we were together, we mentioned the story of Lazarus, who was the beggar and the rich man. And the rich man needed mercy and compassion as much as Lazarus. And that's loving your neighbor, because that beggar, even though he was outside of the gate, he was the neighbor and he needed mercy and compassion as much as the rich man did. So yes, we are to share each other's burden. Share each other's burdens, and in this way obey the law of Christ, Galatians 6:2. In doing so, we help each other in the body of Christ to remain needful of mercy and compassion, to remain, you know, in the mindset of this need of mercy and compassion, that we need it ourselves and we need to share it with others as we strive to live in the Spirit through Christ and with Christ Jesus.
And yes, we are also to judge in the meaning that we are to know the difference between true believers and unbelievers and what is expected of us. Now, reading from 1 Corinthians 6, verses 1 through 11, if any of you has a grievance against another, how dare he go to the law before the unrighteous instead of before the saints? Talk about how we, if we have grievance against another brother or sister in Christ. Do you not know that the saints will judge the world? And if you are to judge the world, are you not competent to judge trivial cases? Do you not know that we will judge angels? How much more than the things of this life?
Amen. And just, you know, be mindful of what we just were saying about judging in the meaning that we are to know the difference between true believers and unbelievers and what's expected of us. That is in context of what we've been saying about the need of mercy and compassion. So being full of the Spirit and having this mercy and compassion that we ourselves have received through Christ's sacrifice on the cross, we can now offer that to others as we will be the saints, will judge the world. So continuing in 1 Corinthians 6, verses 1 through 11, so if you need to settle even everyday matters, do you appoint as judges those of no standing in the church, no people that aren't in the body of Christ? I say this to your shame. Is there really no one among you wise enough to arbitrate between his brothers and sisters? Instead, one brother or sister goes to law against another, and this in front of unbelievers?
The very fact that you have lawsuits among you means that you are not thoroughly defeated already. You are thoroughly defeated already. Why not rather be wronged? Why not rather be cheated? Instead, you yourselves cheat and do wrong, even against your own brothers.
Do you not know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who submit to or perform homosexual acts, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor verbal abusers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God.
And that is what some of you were, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. And I want to add this one other thing, that we will be judging the world and the fallen angels. And one of the things that is going to be a hallmark of our ruling and reigning with Christ is that we will be judging the world and the fallen angels with him. And we will be ruling over his creation with him. And so learning about how to deliver justice and how to be fair and how to be ethical and moral in our jurisprudence is something that we must, as Christians, learn. And I must say that for Christians to use the courts, the world's courts, the world's systems against one another is, as Paul said, quite shameful, because we are letting the unrighteous determine the judgments between brother and sister. And so we as Christians are going to have to start learning how to judge between one another righteously and not fall back on the unrighteous world for our jurisprudence and our justice among the body of Christ.
Indeed. But you know, we hear so often from many people, well, I can't judge because, well, you know, it says in Matthew or the other Gospels, we better take the log from our own eye. So, we don't judge.
Well, I guess it's how they use the word judge. When I'm referring to judge, I mean we will be determining sentences and guilt when it comes to the world and the fallen angels, but not in this current world, but in the world to come. But for this current world, we need to be able to arbitrate and to determine guilt or innocence and work out a situation where people can actually come to an agreement without falling back on court, the civilian courts. So the judging I'm referring to, the Bible's referring to here, is judgment. We will be judging the world and we will be judging the fallen angels in the world to come. But in this world, we should not be judging ourselves. However, judgment is really judging is really referring to guilt or innocence when it says we should not judge. What we should be doing is discerning right,
yes,
from wrong.
Amen.
And calling wrong wrong and calling right right. Now, that's not judging. That's discernment and standing up for righteousness. That's simply being salt and light.
Amen.
But we do not determine the destiny of human beings, whether they're going to hell or going to heaven, and in this life. This is not our job. But when I say judge, I'm talking about arbitration between brothers and sisters, bringing peace between one another. That's the kind of judging we're referring to. So it depends on how you use the word. And it also determines on the context. The world to come, we will be sitting as judges against the wicked and against the fallen angels. And that will be our job. And we will also be ruling and reigning with Christ in the new creation. So that is something that will be our task, our job. And we should learn to practice justice in this life in preparation for what's ahead.
Amen.
And So that's basically all we have to add for this this Lions tip. I hope it's been a blessing to you, and I hope that you will join us again next time.